Welcome back. This session I'd like to focus on a second strand of information trading. The last session we looked at following insiders in companies, you know, managers, board directors, essentially the SEC classification of insiders. In this session I want to focus on another group that you would assume knows more about the company than you do, which is equity research analysts who track the company on a day-to-day basis. Before I embark on looking at this process, first, let's think about how equity research is set up or structured, at least in the U.S. and pretty much all over the world. In the U.S., if you're an equity research analyst, you're assigned a sector. It could be telecom, it could be social media. You're given a group of companies to track. So if you're a sell-side analyst, you might be given 15, 20, 25 companies to track. And often, all you do is track those companies essentially for the rest of your life. That's a pretty depressing thought, but that's all you do. So essentially, it allows you to become an expert on these companies. So let's think about what analysts do that gives them this special place. They do have access to all the public information that you do, and sometimes to private information from managers. The SEC clearly frowns on that process. They're sector specialists. Because they track 15 or 20 companies in a sector, they have a much greater incentive to invest in actually learning more about the sector. And they do learn more about the sector as they stay as analysts in that sector for an extended period. And finally, once they use this information to do two things. One is they make earnings forecasts for companies. So for the next earnings announcement, say, this is what I think the earnings will be. And they make overall recommendations on the company. These recommendations are offered to their clients, who might be portfolio managers or large investors, on whether they should buy the stock, hold the stock, or sell the stock. So what I'd like to look at is both aspects of what analysts do, both the earnings announcement side and the recommendation side, to see if there are things we as investors can use to make money off one or both of these phenomena. Before we do that, though, it's worth noting that analysts don't track every company, that the companies that they're attracted to tend to be larger companies rather than smaller companies. And this graph actually looks at the number of analysts tracking companies based on the size of the company. So the largest companies have as many as 20, 25 analysts tracking them. And the smallest companies, there might be some companies with no analysts, but even small companies sometimes have analysts. The average number of analysts there is 3. In fact, if you look across companies, here are the 3 variables that seem to determine whether analysts track a company. One is the market cap of the company. The larger the market cap, the more likely it is to be followed by analysts. The second is the more institutions hold a company, the greater the percentage of stock held by institutions, the more likely it is to be followed by analysts. And the third is, and it's not clear which direction the cause and effect goes. Maybe institutions are attracted to companies with analysts following them, or analysts go to companies or institutions hold them. Whatever the reason, there is a correlation, but there might not be a causation. And third, the analysts tend to follow companies where there's a lot more trading volume, more liquid companies rather than less liquid companies. So with that background, let's think about the first the most common output that you get from analysts, which are earnings forecasts. These earnings forecasts for most U.S. companies are ahead of quarterly earnings announcements. So basically, analysts spend a substantial amount of the time trying to forecast what that next earnings announcement will deliver. And they constantly update these numbers. So if you track analyst forecasts of earnings, they'll update them every week, every 2 weeks, every 4 weeks, depending on information they get about those earnings. So let's think about that information that goes into these earnings forecasts. It could be firm-specific information that has come out since the last announcement. Companies often reveal more information about themselves beyond the earnings announcement. So a company like Apple might meet with its developers and talk about its future plans. So that information is going to get incorporated into the earnings forecast. There's macroeconomic data coming out. You know, how strong is the economy or how weak is it? What's happening to interest rates, inflation? Those things can get incorporated into your forecast. Thirdly, there could be information you get from competitors revealing their earnings. So if you're tracking automobile companies, and let's say that Ford reports earnings, you might use the information in that earnings report to update your earnings forecast for GM and Chrysler. There could be private information about the firm, and here you're trading on that gray space where you might get in trouble with the SEC. But to the extent that there's information that other people don't have about the company, you might incorporate that into the earnings announcement, and any other public information that's out there. You know, it could be sector-wide, it could be trade group information, can also get incorporated into earnings. What I'm trying to say is the earnings forecasts from analysts should contain a lot more information than just what's in historical earnings, right? So let's stop and ask the question, are analysts' earnings forecasts much better than just using historical earnings? The good news first. If you use an analyst forecast of earnings, you will tend to do better, get closer to the next earnings that is actually to the actual earnings than using just historical earnings. In other words, if you just took past earnings per share and you forecasted out the next earnings per share based on just past earnings per share using a time series model or just historical growth, you're going to do less well than you would if you used analyst forecasts. That's the good news. The bad news is you're not going to do that much better with analyst forecasts. So if you're thinking about improvement, you're not talking about dramatic improvement. It's fairly small improvement. So, which is surprising. Given all that additional information that's brought into the game, you'd think that analyst forecasts would do a lot better. And while the study I'm quoting is from 1978, more updated studies also back this up. There isn't that much you gain by using analyst forecasts. And much of what you gain is for the near term. In other words, the superiority of analyst forecasts is for 1 quarter ahead earnings, not for 1 year ahead or 5 year ahead earnings. So analyst forecasts of earnings are not as good as we think they are. I mean, given the kind of information and the resources that analysts bring to the game, you'd think they'd do better. And in fact, the mistakes that analysts seem to make seem to be correlated with macroeconomic conditions. So in this graph, for instance, you see the forecast error. On the right axis, so basically you see the forecast error, and then you see the industrial production on the left axis. So as industrial production improves, you see the forecast error tends to become much more negative. So analysts tend to underestimate earnings when the economy has been doing well for an extended period, and they tend to overestimate earnings when the economy has been. This is not an indictment of analysts. In fact, this is exactly what you'd expect. Because when the economy does much better than expected, earnings are going to get pushed up because of that, and analysts could not forecast that into their original estimates. But it is surprising that analysts don't seem to catch up even after an extended period when the economy is doing well. Now, if you look at long-term forecasts, there's split evidence. There are studies that indicate that the long-term forecasts from analysts are pretty much useless. And there are other studies that say there's some value, but even the ones that are optimistic that find some value don't find, again, that much improvement from using analyst forecast of growth for the next 5 years as opposed to using just historical data. Now, if you look at the market reaction to earnings revisions, it's interesting. Here's again the good news. On average, if you look at companies where earnings have been revised upwards, so revisions are when analysts increase their expected earnings per share for a company based on the information they've received. If you invest in companies right after earnings have been revised up, those companies seem to go up. In fact, they earn an average excess return of about 4-5% in the 4 months after, the revisions. And if you take the most extreme revisions, the biggest upward revisions, you actually can earn an even larger return. On an annualized basis, you could have earned about a 14% return as opposed to the index return over that period of only 7%. But again, if you dig a little deeper, it turns out that much of that return that you earn from those revisions happens in the weeks after the revision, not in the years after. Which raises an interesting question as to whether these revisions are being followed by clients who are then trading on those revisions, pushing up the stock price. Whatever the reason, though, there is a relationship between earnings revisions and what happens in the weeks after those revisions. So positive revisions, prices go up. Negative revisions, prices go down. And this has also been found in other countries. A study that looked at the UK, France, and Germany found that buying stocks after the most positive revisions did in fact result in excess returns over and above what the index would have earned the weeks and months following those revisions. Now, if you decide as an investor to go down the strategy of investing after analysts revise earnings up, the problem you're going to face is you're building your investment strategy on two of the weakest links in financial markets. The first is earnings reports that come out from companies, and they're weak because the accounting behind them often allows companies discretion And companies play games with earnings. And we know they're playing more games now than they did 20 years ago. And analyst forecasts of earnings, which we know tend to often be biased upwards. Now, second, I think that a factor to keep in mind here is much of the return you might be earning might be a self-fulfilling prophecy. These analysts revise earnings upwards. They transmit that information to their clients who then trade based on that information, pushing up prices. So there might be nothing fundamental going on. It might just be that liquidity effect of investors coming in and buying after the revisions, and that might fade. It is a short-term strategy. It's not a long-term strategy. So you don't buy after revisions and hold stocks for 5 years. You hold them for 3 weeks or 5 weeks, which means if you don't get out at the right time, your returns could get wiped out. And finally, not all analysts seem to be made equal. Some analysts seem to have a much longer-term impact than others. So if you look across analysts who have a lot of following have a much greater impact, and analysts who seem to do their homework have the impact on prices lasts a much longer time period. So all factors to keep in mind as you think about, should I be out there using analyst revisions or earnings reports or earnings forecasts to invest in companies? Now let's look at the other aspect of what analysts do, is they put out buy recommendations and sell recommendations. Before you get too excited though, recognize that there's a bias in this process. In fact, what I have here are the number of companies on which analysts have the highest recommendation, then the high, then neutral, then low, then the lowest. Notice the skew in the distribution. Lots more companies have buy recommendation than sell recommendations. So neutral recommendation might as well be a sell recommendation, because that seems to be the lowest that most analysts aspire to push a stock down to. So a factor to keep in mind here is don't get too caught up in what the actual recommendation is, the change in the recommendation from a strong buy to a weak buy that might actually be worth looking at. Now, do recommendations affect stock prices? They seem to. So this is actually from a study that looked at the short term, 3 days after, 1 month after, 3 months after, and 6 months after. Those are the four columns for stocks added to buy recommendations, removed from buy recommendations, added to sell recommendations, and removed from sell recommendations. A couple of interesting things. Stocks that are added to buy recommendations, the long-term positive impact of a stock added to buy is less than the long-term price impact of a sell recommendation. So sell recommendations seem to have more long-term impact than buy recommendations. But added to sell and removed from sell, there's not that much difference from the two groups. So there is information in recommendations, but again, it's noisy. Not all stocks where you see buy recommendations do you see stock prices go up. In fact, I would argue that the big news is when you see sell recommendations rather than buy recommendations pop up on a stock. And you always have to temper both what you read in earnings revisions and recommendations with any fears that you might have of conflicts of interest. This is actually from a study that looks at analyst recommendations, but then classifies the analysts into those people who are underwriters. So these are recommendations of companies right after public offerings. And it looks at buy recommendations from bankers who are underwriters in the offering versus bankers who are non-underwriters, not surprisingly. The buy recommendations from those who underwrite a public offering are not that useful. In fact, they're actually, these are buy recommendations. The stock price actually decreases in the months after. Non-underwriters, there's much more value to knowing whether there's a buy recommendation on the stock. So the bottom line is, can you make money of analyst recommendations? Yes, but not as much as you think. There is some money to be made both after earnings revisions and recommendations, but it's not clear whether you're making money because of a self-fulfilling prophecy where other people are trading and pushing the price up, because the long-term impact seems to be relatively small. So if you decide to use analysts in your investment strategy, here's what I would do. Start off by looking at all analysts, but don't use all of them. Look at the most influential, the people who have the biggest following, and the most content. How do you measure most content? Look through the reports, the analyst reports. You're looking not just for numbers, but for a story that is backed up by the numbers, a narrative that actually makes sense. So start by identifying the analysts you're going to track. Screen out analysts who have serious potential conflicts of interest. So don't look at recommendations from investment banks after IPOs on the companies they've just taken public. Then when your investment recommendations, do them at the time the recommendation comes out, because waiting 2 weeks or 4 weeks after the recommendation, it's already too late. And then watch these analysts for signals that they've changed their mind. Small signals where they go from strong buy to weak buy, that's a signal for you to get out. And if you do that, perhaps, you can incorporate analyst recommendations into your investment strategy and make money off it. Thank you very much for